I think two of the most important programs that every Linux user should learn is Vim and Emacs. Vim and Emacs, they're total game changers. I know for me, when I first learned Vim, I was amazed. It completely opened my eyes. It opened a whole new world of possibilities open to me because, you know, Vim changed the way I thought about text editing. It changed the way I thought about computers in general because of how much more efficient and how much more work I could get done quicker. And it's extensible, meaning you can configure it to your liking to do exactly what you want it to do. And it was just a complete different way of doing things compared to your old plain text editors like Nano, Gedit, Notepad, and Windows, things like that. Vim, seriously, it changed my life. And that's why I promote things like Vim and Emacs on the channel so much, is because I know if you guys give it a try, they'll change your life too. But, you know, one of the most common complaints I get from you guys that are trying out Vim or trying out Doom Emacs is, hey, this is hard. You know, I can't learn this stuff. This is complicated. This is going to take me years and years to learn. And even after putting all this time into it, I probably still can't learn it because it's just too dang complicated, DT. And I'm telling you, it's not. You could seriously learn Vim in about 2 weeks. Vim is not very complicated to learn at all, at least, you know, the basics of Vim. And then once you learn Vim, transitioning to something like Doom Emacs is rather easy because, for the most part, text editing inside Doom Emacs is done with Evil Mode. Evil Mode in Emacs is basically a Vim emulation layer. Basically, it's your text editor in Emacs is essentially Vim. So if you already knew Vim, then making the switch to Doom Emacs, it's not hard at all. Of course, the problem is documentation. You know, where can you go to read and learn all of this stuff? Well, the cool thing about Vim, so let's assume you're starting with Vim, which is definitely where I would start. Vim is installed on most Linux distributions. I know Ubuntu doesn't have it installed out of the box. So on Ubuntu, sudo apt install Vim. And then once Vim is installed, Vim comes with its own instruction manual called the Vim Tutor. Type Vim Tutor, all one word, and hit enter. And this instruction manual, you're in Vim here, and then you just go through and just read. It tells you HJKL are the motion keys, so L moves me to the right, H moves me to the left, J will move me down, K will move me up. You know, this is lesson one, essentially, right? And then you just go and go through each lesson, such as learning how to exit Vim by typing colon Q, and then you'll eventually learn how to delete characters with the X key. So if I put my cursor over the F in fix and I hit X on the keyboard, I deleted that character. U to undo, etc., etc. You'll learn, you know, almost all of the basics with Vim from the Vim Tutor. It takes about 20 to 30 minutes to go through the entire Vim Tutor. And then once you go through it, you know it because you read it, right? And not only did you read it, it tells you to actually type these commands such as DW to delete a word, right? You know, this is a great way to learn something because if I go to the word move here and I type DW to delete word, U to undo, because you've had to actually physically do this to go through the lesson, you will forever remember it. It's like learning to ride a bike, right? You never forget how to ride a bike once you took the time to actually learn it. The same thing with the Vim Tutor. You're going to go through this for about 20 or 30 minutes, and at the end, you're going to know how to use Vim. And after running through the tutor, at that point, what you should do is then force yourself to use Vim that day forward. And after about 2 weeks of using nothing but Vim, you'll have it, right? You'll have it down pat. It'll get to the point where after a while, you will become so used to doing everything the Vim way, you can't go back to your old plain text editor because now that way of doing things is the incorrect way because you've learned this new, more correct way, a much more efficient way that it's, you know, it's weird because when you first switch to Vim, it's strange, it's alien, it's foreign. You know, things are strange because you're not used to moving in this weird way. After a couple of weeks, you learn to love moving the Vim way, so much so that you can no longer do plain text editing the way you used to. It becomes physically painful, like it actually hurts your heart to go back to the old way. And then after that, I think the next step, the next evolution, is then trying to transition to something like Doom Emacs, because I think that is the next step in the progression, right? So this is Doom Emacs. Let me launch my doomconfig.org here. This is my Doom Emacs config file. It just gives us something to look at here. Now, again, the great thing about Doom Emacs, because it uses evil mode, if you know Vim, you know text editing inside, you know, this document, you know, all of your standard Vim commands are going to work. I'm not going to show you any of that. I've done videos in the past showing you guys the basics of the Vim commands, so check out those videos if you haven't seen them. But I think the problem that most new Doom Emacs users have is just the entire Emacs ecosystem, because it's more than a text editor, right? It's got a file manager built into it. It's got various terminal emulators. It's got a shell. It's got a web browser built into it. And it's got games. You can play Tetris inside Emacs. And it's the whole ecosystem that there's so much to it. How can you possibly learn all of this stuff? And I think a lot of people don't realize that Emacs is self-documenting, meaning every single function, every single variable, every single piece of code that's written in Emacs Lisp that has anything to do with Emacs is documented inside Emacs, meaning you can literally look up everything there is to know about Emacs within Emacs itself. So to look up any kind of documentation information on Emacs, there are various commands that begin with the word describe. So if you do meta X inside Emacs, Alt X on the keyboard, you get your command prompt and type the word describe dash. And you will see describe dash key, describe dash character, describe dash face, describe dash font, yada, 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 right? There's a whole bunch of describes. There's describe variable, describe function. These are various describe commands where, for example, if I did describe function and hit enter, it's going to want to know what function do I want to get a description for. So I'm actually not sure what function I would want to look for something here. I'm just going to search for something Dear Ed related. Maybe I want to look up Dear Ed dash tree dash up. So that's a Dear Ed function. And it will tell me exactly what Dear Ed dash tree dash up does. It tells me the arguments. It is an auto-loaded interactive Lisp function that's found in Dear Ed dash aux.el. If I click on that link, it will actually open that particular Emacs Lisp document where I can actually read the code where that function is defined, and there is that function. So if I had any questions about what that function is or what it does, I mean, I can look at the source code right here and see. Now let me close out that bottom split. Now Doom Emacs makes these describe function, describe variable, describe keybinding commands very easy, because in Doom Emacs we have keybindings that begin with space and then H for help. And you can see after I type space H, then I get the list of the next keys that I could hit, including K for describe key, if I needed to describe a key binding, or I could do V for describe variable. I could do F for describe function. So space HF for describe function again. And this time I'm going to look up something, and I'll look up something related to Ivy. I don't know. I'm just going to find a random function, because I get a list of every single function that Emacs knows about. And it's going to know about everything, because again, Emacs is self-documenting. Every time anybody writes any kind of piece of code, anytime I define my own functions and my own config files and things like that, immediately Emacs knows about them, and they're available for lookup using something like describe function. So if I wanted to read about iv-read, this particular function, you know, I get this bottom split here and it tells me all about it. It's going to give me some information, maybe some examples of how it's used. And of course, again, it will tell me exactly where the source code for iv-read is found. It's found in this file here called iv.el. If I clicked on it, you know, then I could actually read exactly where iv-read is defined, which is right here. As a matter of fact, when you click on it, it actually goes not just into that file, but it finds the function that you were looking up inside that file. So how cool is that? So let me close that split. So that's describe function. That's probably the most common thing you'll do is describe a function. Functions are commands within Emacs, essentially. You sometimes will use describe variable, which is space HV inside Doom Emacs. And this is where you can look up a variable definition. For example, maybe I wanted to look up a variable for org-table-any-line-regexp. No, it will tell me exactly what that value is currently set to. And you see here is the value for it. So that is a quick and handy way to get a variable definition. Now, one I use sometimes is help for key bindings, for describe bindings, which I believe in Doom Emacs is space HB. Actually, it's space HBB, so two Bs. So one more B, describe binding, and it will give you a list of every single key binding that Doom Emacs knows about. You can see space tab is the prefix command, space return is bookmark dash jump. And of course, there's going to be like literally thousands of key bindings available there. If you want to describe a specific key binding, meaning I'm going to type a key binding and I want you to tell me what that does, you could do space HK for key and then press the key that you need a binding for. So maybe I want to do space H and then F, and it will actually tell me what space HF is, which is the describe function command that we talked about earlier, where we were looking up definitions for functions. It's actually console-describe-function is actually the program that particular key binding launches. So again, Emacs self-documenting is going to tell you exactly everything you want to know, from functions, variables, key bindings, key presses. It'll tell you pretty much anything you want to know. Just know in Doom Emacs, do space H for a prefix, and then the rest of the help commands are listed here in which key. It will tell you exactly what you could search as far as some help documentation on. Now, one of the things I do want to briefly mention is when you're learning Vim and then you're learning Emacs, they're very different in the way they function and feel. And this causes some people some frustration, because with Vim, Vim is something you just kind of end up in eventually. You open a terminal, you CD around a directory system, you find a file that you were looking for, and then you open it in Vim, you know, inside that terminal that you were already playing with. So basically, Vim is something you just kind of eventually find yourself inside. Where Emacs is the opposite. Emacs, you actually launch Emacs and start inside Emacs and do everything from within Emacs, right? You never leave Emacs. You never just happen to end up in Emacs. No, Emacs is this thing you open at first and do everything from within Emacs, and it's completely different than Vim. And a lot of people find that workflow strange, but not because it's weird. It's just because it's different. It's not the Vim way. And you know, when you're transitioning from Vim to Emacs, you got to learn to do things the Emacs way. The cool thing about doing everything from within inside Emacs, you know, just launching Emacs and then just being inside Emacs forever, is it makes a lot of things so much better than the Vim way of doing things. For example, you know, how would I SSH into a remote computer using Vim? Well, what you would do is you would open a terminal, and in that terminal, you would SSH into the remote machine. And then once you remote into that remote machine, then you launch Vim on that remote machine. No, not Vim on your computer, but Vim on the remote computer. Hopefully it's configured to your liking, and then you do everything on the remote machine, on Vim, on that remote machine. That's not the way it works in Emacs. In Emacs, you're never going to remote into a remote machine and then launch Emacs on that remote machine. You know, a lot of people are often confused about this. Is how do you SSH with Emacs? Well, you just SSH from within your Emacs. For example, this is Emacs on my local machine. Now, if I wanted to remote into one of my web servers, all I would do is space period to launch find file here, the find file command. And basically, think of it as a little mini file manager. And you can see right now I'm in my .config directory. I'm in .config/doom because that's the directory that this file we were viewing exists. So anytime you launch find file, it starts in the directory that you're currently working in. But I could navigate to anywhere on my file system. So if I wanted to, I could go to the root file system. But here's the thing. It doesn't have to be a local file system. I could do something remote from within the file manager here inside Emacs. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have that opening slash, and then I'm going to type SSH colon, and then name of user at IP address. So I'm going to do root at distro.tube is the domain name for one of my websites. And if I, at the end, I need to do a colon for a location slash, which is the root directory on that remote machine. If I hit enter, it's going to ask me for a password. I'm going to enter my password, and you can see it decrypted the GPG key, so everything should be good there. Now, it's taking a second because it should have launched me into the remote directory. There it goes. So this is the root directory on that remote web server for distro.tube, and you can see I'm logged in as root at distro.tube. So that's how I SSH into a remote machine using Emacs. And really, I mentioned that because I get so many people that really are just genuinely confused about that. They're like, man, how can I spend all of these weeks and months tweaking my Emacs config, but I have to remote into so many servers as part of my job? You know, Emacs is not going to be on that remote server, and they don't realize it doesn't matter. This isn't like Vim, where anytime you remote into the machine, you're using Vim on that machine. Emacs doesn't work like that. When you have your Emacs set up, Emacs is forever what you work in. Your Emacs on your local system, you can remote into a million different machines. You're going to use your Emacs. And by the way, that program that I just showed you is a program called Tramp. Tramp is built into Emacs. It's basically how Emacs can SSH into remote machines, and by simply just, you know, hitting space period, so getting into the find file, and then they're just typing an address. Make sure your address starts with slash SSH colon, and then name of user at IP address. Now, one other cool thing that Tramp can do, and this is kind of a hack, but it does work, is a lot of people have this problem in both Vim and Emacs where you open up a file that you don't have permission to edit. And you start playing around with this file, and then you go to write it, and you can't write it because you were editing a read-only file. Well, you know, you're kind of in a pickle, right? Because you spent all this time editing this file, and you can't even save it. Well, the great thing about Emacs, and especially Doom Emacs, is they actually have these custom functions that are built in. If I do a search for sudo, so if I do metax sudo, you see there are three different custom Doom Emacs functions. One of them is doom slash sudo find file. Another one is doom slash sudo this file, and then we have doom slash sudo save buffer. What these are custom functions that use Tramp, because Tramp has the ability, you know, if you find yourself inside a file that you didn't have permissions for, Tramp can elevate those permissions for you, basically leveraging SSH essentially. And that's what these custom functions, I believe, in Doom Emacs are utilizing. So this sudo find file command, which they have hotkeyed space fu, you know, if for whatever reason I find myself in this file, of course I have permissions to edit this file, but let's assume I don't. Let's assume this is something in my root directory and I didn't have permissions for it. Space fu is the sudo find file command. So basically this opens us up in the file manager again, in the working directory. And then I go and navigate to that document that I want to open up as root. But maybe I don't want to leave the document I'm already working on. Maybe I just want to open up this particular document as root. Well, remember, if I do metax sudo, there was this command, sudo this file, meaning just give me elevated privileges on this file that I'm working on right now. And that's space F capital U. So if I right now do space F capital U, it's going to ask me for my sudo password for the root user at localhost. So the root user on this computer system. So all I would have to do, give my sudo password, and now I have sudo privileges editing this particular file. So that's just a little bit of why I really like Emacs compared to Vim as far as elevated privileges. When you find yourself, I find myself in these files all the time where I'm in slash etsy and I'm working on a config file and oops, you don't have permissions. And you know, that sudo find file command inside Doom Emacs is a real lifesaver. And also the ability to SSH, you know, from directly inside Emacs. Again, it's one of those things that you know, Vim users kind of find weird. It's like you never leave Emacs, right? You do everything inside Emacs. You got the file manager, right? You SSH inside Emacs. I can do pushes to my GitLab from inside Emacs. I can do everything from inside Emacs, where Vim, you're pretty much doing all of that other stuff at the command line, and you're only entering Vim when you need to edit text, right? Vim is more of a strictly a text editor, where Emacs is more of a complete ecosystem that you log into and you live in all day. But I got sidetracked a little bit there. Really, what I wanted to show you guys was the documentation. So for those of you, again, you're wanting to learn Vim, Vim Tutor takes you like 20, 30 minutes. Vim Tutor, very easy. You can learn Vim seriously in 2 weeks, and you don't have to be a rocket scientist to learn Vim. Vim is very, very easy to learn. And it's one of those things, once you learn it, you know it. And then after that, if you want to transition to trying to learn Doom Emacs, it's a little bit more of a chore to learn. You know, there's a bigger learning curve, but it's not hard. Again, Emacs is self-documenting. Every variable, every function, every piece of code inside Emacs, even the code that you write yourself as part of your config files or custom plugins that you create or whatever, everything that is written in Emacs Lisp and is a part of Emacs is described inside Emacs. So there's never a situation where there's some information that's hidden away from you that you can't find, that you can't look up and get the information that you need. Now, before I go, I need to thank a few special people. I want to thank the producers of this episode: Devin, Gabe, James, Matt, Michael, Mitchell, Scott, Paul, Wes, out of order, Kami, Alan, Linux, Ninja, Chuck, Commander Angry, Kurt, Dioka, David, Dylan, Gregory, Heiko, Koska, Lee, Max, and Mike, Nitrix, Arion, Alexander, Peace, Arden, Fedora, Polydite, Raver, Red Prophet, Steven, and Willie. These guys, they're my highest tiered patrons over on Patreon. Without these guys, this rant about Vim and Emacs, it wouldn't have been possible. The show is also brought to you by each and every one of these ladies and gentlemen. All these names you're seeing on the screen, these are all my supporters over on Patreon, because I don't have any corporate sponsors, because corporate sponsors, they don't sponsor Vim and Emacs, right? Nobody sponsors Vim and Emacs. That's nerdy stuff, right? It's just me and you guys, the community. I depend on your guys' support for everything I do. So if you like my work and want to support me, look for DistroTube over on Patreon. All right, guys. Peace. VS Code wishes it was Emacs.